Lord, praise God for a phenomenal women here at our church. But then we're going to find ourselves in the Gospel of John, chapter number 12. The Gospel of John, chapter number 12. John, chapter number 12. For about 15 minutes. Since the next day, the great crowd that had followed the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." I'm going to stop right there, my beloved brothers and sisters. Please come to the top of this Palm Sunday. The thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. The thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. As it is, the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. My beloved brothers and sisters, in 1970, in the International Ski Flying Championship, that was in Oberstdorf, West Germany, a Slovenian ski jumper named Vinko Bogata made a faulty ski jump that became the personification of ABC's Wide World of Sports. His failure, often replayed as the marketing mantra of the show, pitted Bogata's ski jump error as the most replayed clip in the history of the show. It aired consistently from 1970 to 1998. At the time, commentator Jim McKay talked around the moment by saying that it was the difference between the thrill of victory and the agony. I know that many of us have watched a man's sports on the weekends, and we would see this guy come down just swallowing, and he would come down in a ramp of ice, amen. It looks like before he would jump off the end, he would have, amen, what seemed to be a catastrophic accident. Amen. As he flung into the crowd, and his skis went in different directions. Although it seemed that this man, my beloved brother and sister, as if this man died in his failed jump, he actually suffered a mild concussion and a broken ankle. But his popularity in the United States and abroad brought him fame and somewhat prestige as a result of his failure. And from Jump Street in today's message, a Pharisee would be perplexed in realizing that what happened with Christ, what Christ did for us, was simply to lose, but we actually won. The paradox of this predicament was also, now he committed no sin, Jesus became sin. That you and I might be made righteous, the righteousness of God through him. He went into Jerusalem as a common citizen, but was profiled and indicted as a terrorist. He became a victim so that you and I become victorious. So we have to be careful by faith not to pout, but rather on the shout. Because the battle has been fought and the victory has already been won. To appreciate this Palm Sunday celebration, the story of the triumphal entry is one of only three stories that are found in all four Gospels. The feeding of the multitude being one, when Jesus began his ministry in Galilee being the other, and the third one, his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. To dwell even further, any interested and inquisitive Bible reader will appreciate the imagery of the scene of the triumphal entry. And I pray all of us become familiar with a mental condition called apophenia. This condition is perhaps a good thing because apophenia is the tendency to perceive meaningful connections between unrelated things or random things such as objects and ideas. We hear every year that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. You all hear that every Palm Sunday, don't you? And the crowd celebrated and shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." We can imagine the scene must have looked like, what the scene must have looked like. But the other images of the scene tie together what we imagine and how we ought to feel. I wish I had a witness here. Like I told you the other Sunday, amen, when your house is not clean, you ought to feel a certain kind of way. But every time you get, amen, in or surround the things of God, it ought to be some things that you ought to see that can help you identify that I'm at the right place at the right time. You don't want to go, amen, into a shower or bathroom and see a ring around the tub when you know it's time for you to take a bath. But boy, when you go into a hotel on vacation or go into someone's house, amen, avail of the facility, amen, it makes you feel more comfortable and safe knowing that you're in a clean place. The same way when you come to God's house, amen, you ought to feel the Spirit. It ought to be something in your bones and to your hands and to your body work, amen, to make you feel like this is supposed to be the presence of God. And I don't know if anybody has ever been like that who have that divine intuition that said, yes, I'm in the right place at the right time. So therefore, amen, I might as well go ahead and stop because I know I'm in God's presence. Yes, my beloved brothers and sisters, so this idea of this mental condition known as apophenia, amen, is one of perfect is obsessed, amen, with imagery and scene. The question I want us to consider about faith is what connection does the donkey and the palm branches have in common as it relates to Jesus? It's got to be something because, I don't know, for many years, for about 7 or 8 years, I heard it here on Palm Sunday about the donkey. You know, one sermon, 1 year, I heard about the branches, amen. And I wanted to understand, yeah, I know that Jesus wrote this donkey into Jerusalem, amen, amen, at the feast time, amen, and he went in, and I've heard so many people speak from the subject, amen, he went in so we could come out. Yes, I hear so many people say, he did it for me, and I want you to know, I talked about the two-faced crowd 1 year, where everybody that thought it had nothing to say, amen, at the trial, okay, trying to get a witness, and so many people have talked about, amen, and one of the same folks, amen, that shouted Hosanna, well, they're the same folk who said crucify. We don't really know, but only thing we know is some of them, amen, were in the same crowd, just like this crowd, amen, who said something and did say something, but at the end, you all still have a right to the tree of life, regardless of what you did or what did not do. Yes, amen. I can be a help to you this morning. We must see that what took place was that Jesus in Matthew 21 instructed his disciples to go into the village and that they would find a goat, a donkey, and a colt and to untie them and bring them to him. This was Jesus' call. The other people, upon hearing that he was on his way into town, got palm branches to celebrate his arrival. That was the people's response. Therefore, it's just like when we understand that church, amen, and ministry and preaching is nothing but call and response. Amen. Many times you hear the preacher say, can I get a witness? And you hear somebody say, well, you got one. Amen. Most times you hear people say, the pastor will say, amen, and your response, amen, will be amen. It's almost like monkey see, monkey do. And I don't know about any of you, but amen, in your club days, the DJ, amen, was scratching and mixing. And he would tell you to raise your hands in the air and raise them just like you just don't care. If you don't mind raising your hands to Jesus, somebody will help us, right? Oh, I'm sorry. Amen. That's all the preaching is for the disc jacket, amen. And what does the disc jacket do? Who does not make the record when he turns it? Somebody's called donkey.
but there was a people in the corner to get the poem back. I'm trying to get all the gifts of bread. It was Judas Iscariot to get the coffee. And I bet it was the poem back that the people gave as their response. Somebody said, well, Papa, amen, why, amen, does the palm of a human hand, amen, is why is it called the palm? You know, you have the exterior, which is the outside, but then you have the inside of your hand, and the difference between the inside and the outside is that there are billions of grippers, amen, on the inside of your hand. You really don't understand that your hand are really like suction cups. Can I get a witness? Because the bill is slick as a wheel in the outside of your hand. You could be able to hold a glass of water. Amen. The God in his intricate design, and his perfect and wonderful to make an each and every one of us, every one of us here, a palm with some grippers in it. What there's ever now and then, even I can hold something. And then we find, amen, the Latin word palm means, amen, the inside of the hand. And therefore, amen, this palm, when you really look at it, the leaves come about the branches just like your hand. That's why it's called the palm tree. Can I get with it? And the palm in scripture has never just amen to the cry of the victory, but then amen is an action kind of thing, and that it comes to God. That's why I tell us we can't sit in church as if we're constipated, or if we are sick in our life, because the activity of God, the activity of your hand in the midst of worship is the last of all that God can do. That's why even the grandmother of David is the only one who's still alive to live that thing. And if you're looking here, and right there in the midst of it, it's on a calm Sunday, where did it say, amen, meaningful, amen, to what was taking place around the scene? I think Herman Goethe was a German philosopher. I said, it's something called the action label, and the action label meant, amen, it's the location and what's going around in the text. And while everybody is celebrating the fact that Jesus, amen, came into Jerusalem, I'm taking God to the imagery that was taking place. Because we heard that, amen, on the donkey, it symbolized, it said, and what I'm about to do, I'm going to raise the elephant. You're not telling me on that. But when you say, I'm not going to quit, I'm not going to quit, but what I'm going to do is overcome some stuff that mankind could not do on their own. They said, amen, we're coming on the donkey, which is like a defense, a peace, amen, and fight. And this way, when you run in, either the person in the group, or they have any kind of cultivation, what the thing with God, you will find out that at least if somebody is going to fight a battle with me, or for me, without any weapons, I believe I can prove it right now. That's the thing that I'm going to do. How many of you have ever seen Jesus face to face? If you're going to try this morning, I don't need to believe that Jesus made my way out of nowhere. Did you see him with a caterpillar? Did you see him with hammer and nail? Did you see him, amen, putting his fingers on a roof? No, that's why Jesus made my heart in humility and prayer. But I told him to put my hands on him. But the last thing you can do is put my hands on him and keep my authority and bring glory to his name. Now that we understand not that it is different, I mean, we begin to look at the question I want to consider about faith is what connection does the donkey and the palm lead have together? And the other people, upon hearing this, amen, they heard that Jesus was on the way, the text says, they got palm branches to celebrate his arrival. According to John's days, in John chapter number 12, mind you, this is the day after Jesus was at the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. I told John I'm very familiar. He said, therefore, amen, if you're going to be able to, amen, apply the season with absolute to take the storm of every way, that the book of, amen, chronological, you can get to the point. And remember last Sunday, we teach me, Mikasa as Mikasa, which means my house is just up. And you can read the text, Father, right after they left Mary, Martha, and Lazarus' house, the Bible said, it was the next day. In other words, amen, if you read the text completely, it says that the Pharisees were there, plotting to kill Lazarus and Jesus, because the world had gone after them. And here it is the next day. I want to know what happened yesterday. Because they didn't kill Jesus and Lazarus yesterday. And here it is, suffering is the same thing with the same mindset, to keep pushing and screaming and doing the same thing on it, and it still has not worked just yet. The only one that is doing anybody in here that the whole thing is true, and they're in there, and they're the whole thing about it, and it's trying to put your soul of mercy to prove that. How the heck can God put amen to start that verse, amen, to a man and a man, and the woman that God is a man and a rainmaker, amen, who has a bunch of it right there. The journey is not the right thing to do, but what the enemy has to do is call us to the next two or three weeks of this month. To look for, amen, the work, amen, God, because we know it's not going to come to pass. But I come to say the bread of marriage on a calm Sunday, to everything that God says is going to happen to him and his people is going to happen. God gave it to you and give it. I imagine now that after they left the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, like I told you last week, there were several uninvited guests. And they showed up to witness that Lazarus had been raised from the dead. I imagine they left Martha's crib and went back to their homes, telling their family and friends what a time they had over to Martha's house. The news was out there that Jesus was blessing. And like I told you last week, some people would show up to your house uninvited, unexpected, unannounced, unwelcome, unconcerned, just to be known as a hockey player with two hockey sticks. It would be a dream come true if everybody in the crowd was comprised of equal concern, equal appreciation, and equal praise for the same thing. It would be wonderful to know that such, amen, has not become a place where everybody watches, amen, how you pray, you cry, how you sell. See, the domain concern ought to be that the same God that blessed the person sitting next to me was the same God that's coming down my road. And I believe that there's somebody in the house of God today, amen, you may be able to look down your road and it may not be anybody there. But I challenge you to get next to somebody because God may bless them and you want to be next to one. Take a time to have made up and go scoop a little crap and let all of it to you. Because I'm not going to live this place because my God has started to work around and it's just a little bit of a mess. Well, the Bible says, we're two or three, and get it together in his name. You're the Bible in the midst. Just to make it go up with God in the midst of a fire of things. Stop with yourself in a different time. See, if I come in here, stop right where you're going right now, in the pocket of a fucking different time. Stop with yourself in the midst of a fire of things. Look at the man that was not to the man. If the man that was not to the man, you're not to the man. 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 I'm going to go to the hospital. find the opposite. And the next thing that the crowd hates is coming to the festival. And I want to know when you're coming to the right, you have to do a festival. And I'm going to do it with me. I'm going to do it with me. I'm going to come to the 25-year-old. The best thing that ever happened is going to happen in the midst of our effort. When I come into the midst of our effort, I'm going to go to the hospital. You do it yourself. That's why I'm not going to go to the hospital. You don't force me to do it. When somebody is telling me, and you're going to meet with somebody's theology here, a minute to be told that the same book that Christ has I'm going to go to the hospital. He's already done it. Going toe to toe with any pastor, preacher, or theologian that wants to say, why did the folk who he blessed, why did he stand up in the courtroom? And you know, when people are already hell bent on convicting you of something, you might as well not even go. And what people do was satisfied with what they said. They say, I'm not going to go in there because I already know the verdict. They're going to kill my Savior. But if you don't die, I don't win. So when you know what you know about the story, Jesus had to die for you to be set free. And therefore, your life ought to be indicative of the fact that you are glad Jesus went through what he went through. Because what he went through benefited you and I. And I'm so glad he went into the. And the Bible, keep reading the text. Because the text says, the Pharisees said, enough is enough. But Jesus tells his disciples, this has to happen. Not just for your sake, but that my Father is glorified. So when I look at the cross, it was victorious that they hung him high. It's just been wrong. But the agony is because a lot of people lost hope until he got up again. And ever since he got up, thousands of years later, all of us still have a chance to eternal life. So guess what? It feels good when you win. But don't knock when you lose. Because if the truth be told, your losses taught you something. And they taught you how to be better. And I want you to know, when you learn from mistakes, the probability of you winning is better than you. So I want to know if there's anybody in the house who is able to celebrate Jesus for the losses that you have. Can you celebrate him for the tears you had to share? Can you celebrate him for the sickness in your body that got your attention to start being better and living healthier? Can you celebrate him for the time when you lost, looked like you lost everything, but God gave it back to you? I'm a living witness, and I'm not afraid to testify. I lost everything I had. Everything, to the point that I was sleeping in my car. Looked at the palm of my hand. I said, God, whatever these hands can do to change my situation. I started working. I started tithing. I started doing what I was supposed to do. I started coming to Bible study. I started not missing any meetings. I became so involved. And before I knew it, everything I lost. And hear me well, I got 5 times what I had. All because I had to go through a loss in order to get the victory. So what Jesus on Palm Sunday, it was victorious going in. But there was agony while he was in there. But baby, when he came out of that grave on that resurrection Sunday morning, he gave all of us a victory that the enemy cannot take away. So if you were here today and you said, Father, I just want to thank you. I lost it.